Good afternoon, everyone. This is Schmidt Ocean Institute, research vessel Falkor and ROV Sebastian. We are currently still at the 40-mile bank site. We've just repositioned the ship slightly to the northeast, and we are descending to about 690 meters for the second recovery of a second colonization experiment. So thanks for coming along. The science team will be with you when we're at the bottom, and you can enjoy our midwater pyrosome bloom as we go down.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Here we are on ROV Sebastian Dive 447, and we're on the 40-mile bank, a little bit west of Los Angeles, southwest of Los Angeles. And we're at 665 meters. We're continuing double dive today, second dive. And this morning we were at 1,000 or so meters and picked up rocks and bone and wood. And now we're going to do that all over again. Most of the team is in the lab busily processing this morning sample. So a bit of a skeleton team of scientists here this afternoon. But we've got the full ROV team. We've got Nick piloting right now, and Cody will be on the manipulator once we find these deployments. We've got a float, a little float out, and everything's sort of clustered together, hopefully. And I'm here for the moment with Paul Jensen before he runs off into the lab. And Paul's a microbiologist at Scripps. And we've also got Nick Mongianardino Coach, who's a postdoc in my lab. And Nick will be logging this afternoon. We're just above the bottom. It's a rocky bank here. We've got sea cucumbers, quite a lot of sponges.
Six-gill?
Yeah, six-gill. Cat shark, maybe. Cat shark in the background. It'll be a relatively brief dive. We're just intending to pick up these samples, maybe pick up a few more rocks in the vicinity, other interesting sponges or corals if we see them. Yeah. You want to do a white balance?
Yeah, we'll get a white balance to take care of
The wood we picked up this morning from 1,000 meters was covered with, or occupied by, wood-eating bivalves, and they, xylophaga, they were, we've cut open some of the wood and they were into the top centimeter of wood after only 9 months. The bones that we put out, chicken bones, some pieces of chicken bone were in the bottom of the cage. They'd fallen or somehow been extracted from the mesh. There was a hole in the mesh, so I think a crab got in there. And the pig bones had some very tiny little bone-eating worms of Ozodax, which I've dissected some out, and we'll be interested to figure out what they are, whether they're a new kind or one that we know. We know about 18 species of Ozodax here in California. Okay.
So it should be on that waypoint, right?
Should be.
Okay.
You've been pretty good so far. 3 out of 4.
So if you fly ahead about 5-6 meters, turn port again, updated waypoint bridge.
Dang, bridge.
Yeah, it was a quick turnaround. The crew did great to set the ROV up again, to come back down. That meant we had to empty all those boxes, if you were watching, and then they had to reload them and fix up the slopes and reset the niskins again. Quite a lot of work, and have lunch and then get it back in the water. So it's been a busy few hours. And meanwhile, all the samples are in the lab underway, being processed for microbiology. The macrofauna is being dissected out. We've got some being kept cold for later on. We're having a bit of a bucket crisis, so we're trying to turn them around as quickly as possible before we bring all these new ones back up. Some heteropolypus. You got plenty of those last time. This looks like there's plenty here. There's another one. Get some replicates. Yeah. We're hunting around for our deployments. There's some tiles have fallen. There's a bunch of tiles on the seafloor here. Only missed it by 5 meters, but well, maybe it's plastic sheets. There's some lots of this sort of pink orange plastic down here. Wasn't us. We're gonna pick our trash up. It's been remarkable so far. Every deployment, 3 out of 3, they've landed right on the site and found the experiments. I've been on other dives where we've been trying to find a whale even, and even with the sonar we just couldn't find it, and for an hour. So the fact we haven't found this straight off isn't surprising at all. But hopefully we're pretty much near the mark. It's just a matter of rotating around and we'll see it.
Y'all had it on a rock outcrop, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. It's got a float with some tape on it. The whale one was partly we had an error in our coordinates. Here we've got coordinates from when we were on the Nautilus and last November, and there's always a little bit of a trick to make sure the coordinates are correct. There can be offsets.
Thank you.
Okay, we're just, Deb's confirming the location. We've done a big loop around. We're just gonna check it out again.
Well, we're gonna get to collect some sponges.
The depth is 693 exactly, and so I don't think you launched anywhere near
662.
We're supposedly right.
The position is the one from your dive plan and the one that you gave in the deflection site. So
really? So I'm wondering.
We're 30 meters. Well, we can't find it. Looks like we've got a little, we're a little bit shallow from, we think it's 30 meters deeper, but our...
Well, it's 30 meters deeper, but I'm sure we can get the right coordinates. We just,
yeah,
see what's wrong with
you. We just have a little error.
Yeah.
Error in our coordinates here. We're just going to...
Can we switch over there for a second? Just
probably. It does explain why we can't find it.
We did a whole little zigzag right there.
You would have found it if it was there.
Just,
it was tenor crabs?
Yeah. Oh, I don't know what that one was. There's a cat shark.
Thing about it being Saturday is not much email traffic from work.
Yes. Oh, there's a nice big coral.
More garbage.
It's a quadrat or
bed frame.
Bed frame. So we've come down slope, so we're now at the right depth. We're just checking the waypoint. There's a glove. That's someone's glove, not ours. Dishwashing glove. We're a lot closer to shore, so we're seeing more trash here than we were the last few days. Looking for some little floats with marking rocks and wood.
Right now we're at 6945.
I'm trying to
Okay, we've got our location.
Update waypoint bridge.
Yeah, I'll be there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
Okay.
I have 32.5983.
We're about 30 meters off now.
Negative.
2 meters off the bottom. We're gonna head over to then where we think it really is, and then hunt around again.
I'll be honest, the terrain looked more correct where we were back over there.
Yeah.
This is getting more sedimentary. Loose
sediment. Maybe turn around and start looking back that way. Get away from more. So that was the last one. That's the last one I'll just give you.
It's
1.18. Looking around right now, we had a waypoint for where we thought our experiments were deployed, and it seems that was off. We had a depth discrepancy and we couldn't find them, and now we realize we have a depth we think is correct, but we're now checking coordinates and still looking for the experiments. So bear with us while we hunt around.
What are these rockfish waiting for? Things that come out of the bottom? It's like they're just waiting for opportunities.
Yeah, this is a little embarrassing. We think we pride ourselves on taking good notes, but somehow we've got a number wrong here. We're going to trust the depth and just run along a transect along the depth that we think is right, and hopefully we'll run across them while we keep checking the records. We've got little rockfish. Paul and I were just wondering. They're sitting out randomly, scattered in the open. They have very large eyes. We're wondering what they're eating down here. Lots of sea cucumbers, probably something called panicia, that are deposit feeding. It's a big one coming up now in the field. Things can move underwater. I remember we had a whale. I was working with Monterey Bay Aquarium and Research Institute, and they deployed a whale at 450 meters or so, and it was on a slope, and the whole slope slid. And when we went back to the original point, the whale was nowhere to be found. And then eventually we did find it, and it had gone downslope 50 meters or so. But we don't expect this to have happened here. We deployed them on rocks. They were just sitting on a rock, weren't they? Yeah. We put them out on a big set of rocks, I remember.
When you look at the picture in the dive plan, does it show the rock?
Yeah.
So that's, yeah, you're looking for a set of rocks like that?
Yeah.
I mean, the rocks might have elevated at a meter or so. Those rocks that just went by there.
Could be, yeah, with the light here, it's so...
Yeah, they're sitting on rocks that are like a... that we wrote down, and the original launch site came from the nav from the ship.
Happens.
And Kira and I took Kira. Kira did the logging for the deployment, and I took her numbers. We've had three sets of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
much is this tongue?
Right there, and there's rock.
32.
Yeah.
5'9".
Yeah.
8'2".
Yeah.
2'3". 6".
118.
Yeah.
There's the glove again. We've been here before.
6'9".
Or it's the other glove.
75. And that's taking us to, it logged it as a depth of
6'8". That's what we launched at. And, I mean, could these be the rocks that we set them out on?
Which sub did it?
Hercules and Nautilus.
You got those out of it's the observations.
It's observations, yes.
That's the same.
There's a hagfish in the frame now. Yeah. This one.
Oh, yeah.
Hagfish. A lizard fish above it.
Yeah.
Well, it's a sit and wait predator, which is probably what the rockfish are doing, but yeah. Without adequate info, it's needle in a haystack, so. We have literally three times prior to this dropped right on the spot. So this is frustrating for us too. The fourth time we're way out. Okay, we've got another waypoint. So we're trying another place to look for these experiments. We're on the 40-mile bank, a little bit west of Los Angeles. That's a snailfish.
Switch out if you want at some point. Yeah, I know.
We're looking for some wood and rocks. And some bones that we deployed last October, November. This morning we picked up a set, if you were watching then, and those are being processed in the lab now. And now we're looking for our second set. Oh yeah, straight ahead. You can see our marker float coming up now.
This course is what was initially right. This
oh.
Wait,
and the wood is completely colonized by xylophaga.
Yeah, 7 meters out. So normally
it's like a fuzzball. The wood is nearly demolished, actually, by the action of these bivalves.
Is that wood?
Yeah.
It's a
cloud of siphons, as Lisa says, and it's got wood debris all around it. You can see the float marker in front, then two pieces of wood, that's Douglas fir, and then we've got some carbonate rocks, and we've got some crabs, and in the background is a minnow trap, which has some bones, hopefully still some bones, that we put out to see if we can get some
wood looks like it's dissolved.
Some bone-eating worms. Yeah, well, these wood-eating bivalves have gone to town, so should be some interesting zooms when we can get down and have a close look at this. Two more Niskins before we settle down?
Yes.
Could we pull a few Niskins before we go down?
Of course. Two?
Yes, please. Pardon me?
The thing in between the carbonate or the basket? It's rock. Okay.
It's a sheet of rock, yeah.
Oh, okay. It looks like it's on metal.
There's a nice sponge back there.
Uh-huh. How could I not?
Well, so much for the xylophaga caring about the oxygen minimum.
Look at it. It's crazy. Yeah.
There's one species that seems to do well through.
Might well be very different to the deeper ones.
But that was the fish.
Could you take two for us as well?
We're taking two for you right now.
Okay. So that's three and four taken. Let's take a look and make sure they fired.
So we just took two water samples. You can see the outer two grey tubes there have now got caps. They're closed. And so we've got water samples now from this depth. We don't want to get water samples when we settle on the bottom because we'll catch some mud.
Get some more pictures of it?
Yeah. Can we get some images while you're scaling up? And we'll zoom in.
Settle down and
Yeah, okay. Well, if you
want
to...
You want an overall? You want to hit pictures of each one?
Let's do an overall and then we'll zoom in on each one.
Okay.
Yeah.
How far are they with the samples? Done a couple? Only a few?
Yeah.
Going slow.
I noticed the tubes twice for
the fuzzies, all of the siphons, the tubes of the little shells, the bivalves. They're breathing tubes basically. The shells are down in the wood, you can't see them. And the shells are probably half a centimeter across and they're sending out their siphons 5 centimeters or so. And there's a halo of destroyed wood around each wood piece. We're just going to get imagery. We have numbers on each of these. And we'll be picking them up. In the cage in the background are some wood pieces. They're still there. There was a mesh bag with chicken bones in it, and then there are pork bones zip-tied to the cage. Nick, if I could get a look in.
Yeah.
We won't be able to do it from the side, so I'll have to be on the fly. Can I zoom?
Yeah, go for it.
Thanks. So there's no major evidence of Ozidax, but the ones this morning we got were also very small. Oh, there is Ozidax. And there's, you can see some little red plumes coming out next to the zip tie, the green zip tie, some little red feathers, and that's the bone-eating worm Ozidax. And Nick's got us up off the bottom, so it's very challenging to try and get a close-up like this. So we know the bone-eating worms are there, so that's great. I can zoom, yeah. Let's get a real close-up. These little red feathers.
You get a few things on there.
Yeah, there's some another several kinds of amphipods and worms. And just near the green zip tie is the bone eating worm. Okay, that's great for that. We could settle down and then we'll have a close up and you could start whichever end you want. So these bone-eating worms are dissolving into the bone, and if you dissect one out, they are mostly females, and most of their body is actually an ovary, and they make, we've done experiments in the lab where we counted how many eggs they were making each day, and it was in the order of 800 eggs per female per day. So they're constantly trickling out eggs, and most of them, they then go in the plankton, and most of them would never find a bone. They, the little larvae live for a couple of weeks, and if they don't find a piece of bone to land on in that time, then they'll die. So the Ozidax are successful through the sheer force of making vast numbers of eggs. The larvae are floating, and what they'll do is float along in the plankton, possibly near the bottom, and randomly they will come across a piece of bone and then settle on it. So there must be literally millions to billions of these larvae in the water at any one time. Here's a piece of carbonate rock. It's in a netting to help contain the animals. On the left you can see a spaghetti worm. Then we've got a couple of decorator crabs standing guard. And yeah, these worms indeed. The ones that land on the bone are the lucky ones. Okay, we can pick up.
Ready?
Yes, please.
Let's do it.
Pick up number one.
All right, we're going for that.
can't see what it is. It'll be
start with a big bio box.
Yeah. Each one of these rocks and or bone or wood will be put in its own compartment, and we're looking at the colonization, so they have to be separate and in its own box. So inside the bio box we've got these containers, and they'll all be removed at the end of today. So there you can see the four compartments, and they can be lifted out of the bio box. So we'll one by one pick up the rocks. Okay, this is rock 7. Southern California Biocarbonate Rock 7. And this is 183. 182. No, we've got... Did we do 4 Niskins?
Yep.
Okay, so 186. See a bright red spaghetti worm on the outer surface of the rock in the mesh.
Yep.
Very good.
Where do you normally put that basket?
It'll be in the front, in the gray, yeah. And now we've got SCB, Southern California Biote, ferromanganese number 2. So this is a rock we picked up out on the San Juan seamount. And we'll compare what colonized the ferromanganese rock versus what colonized a carbonate rock. Nice grab of it. Okay, thanks, Cody.
Do you want to take a zoom of it?
No, that's good.
Okay. Yeah. Do you want to go on 8?
Yeah, fine.
187.
it went in here. Carbonate rock 8, this is our 8th carbonate rock, so we've put out replicate sets of rocks at San Juan Seamount at 1,000 metres and 700 metres, and then this morning there was another set at 1,000 metres, and this is our final pickup here at just on 700 metres. This is a phosphorite rock, another kind of rock that we collected on the last cruise. And it also has a big red spaghetti worm sitting on the outside. Just one frame like that will be good.
Okay.
That's great.
Okay. Got some stuff growing on that poly rope too, you see that?
Yeah.
That blue poly. Those worms as well?
They might be. Yeah. All right. Well done. That's that box filled. We originally grabbed these rocks as representatives of what naturally occurs at the sites they were at a place that methane seep where the carbonate rocks were from, or out on the seamounts for the ferromanganese rock. And once they were studied, they were dried out. And then the idea came to Lisa to deploy them again as colonization experiments. So the rocks were taken for one purpose and then reused for another. And we'll keep these rocks after tonight. And they'll probably end up back at Scripps or Kira Mizell from the USGS, US Geological Survey, might take others as well. We've got a lot of rocks on board now. you can reach the bone from here?
The basket?
Yeah, the bone basket.
I'd be able to.
If we're going to move, I'll zoom in on the wood first, but if you can reach the basket, go for it.
That's it. I'll make sure.
Okay, well.
So I'll go ahead and pick that up.
Yeah. So we've deployed cages like this from Oregon, lots of times in Monterey, California, off San Diego, down as far as Costa Rica, and lots of different kinds of bones, from turtle bones, turkey bones, fish bones, various mammal bones, lamb, cow, pork, and all of them have been colonized by Ozodax. And there's about 30 species of Ozodax known so far after being discovered in 2002. And most of them are known from California. And I expect the ones we'll see on this Ozodax are ones we've known, but there's no reason to think we might find new ones. Might not find new ones on a different deployment, but we'll see. We've sampled pretty heavily now, so I'm expecting we'll know what these are. I'm hoping that we'll take some of these alive back to Scripps and for a study of the live Ozodax in the lab.
You don't want to make the other ones in the same box?
Bone 4.
Did you want me to put one of those woods in there?
Yeah, I'll just get a good close-up first. Okay, thank you.
And I can porch in if you need to get a better view of that.
I think we're good for the far one. Oh, that's wonderful.
We have a whole lot of the combined.
So here you can see the Douglas fir was a beautiful piece of pristine wood 9 months ago, and now it's completely colonized by wood-eating bivalves. Each little bivalve has a single siphon coming out, so each little tube you can see coming out there is an individual bivalve. And then there are some sandy tubes for some polychaetes. And the bivalves themselves are probably about a centimeter inside the wood. And they're dissolving away the cellulose of the wood in symbiosis with some special bacteria. So wood that falls out into the seafloor from the land is routinely colonized and destroyed by this group. These are the ones that live in the deep sea, called xylophagids. There's another group. The shallow water forms are called shipworms or pteridinids. And they make more gallery-like tunnels in the wood. These ones we're looking at now make little spheres in the wood. And we'll just can you porch in a little bit? Thanks, Nick.
Got it.
And both the pieces of wood are pretty heavily colonized. We had another two pieces out at 1,000 meters where the oxygen level's higher, and we expected that this wood here would be less colonized. And in fact, we're surprised. It's got more xylophaga on it, even though the oxygen level's far lower than we saw this morning down at 1,000 meters. This wood would probably be gone in another few months. You'll see when we pick up these wood pieces that the siphons will retract and it'll suddenly go much more smooth and wood-like.
What's the black part? Is that the net?
Yes, there's a mesh net around this. Could we have the lasers for a minute on this too, please?
Lasers coming on, sir. You got lasers.
Great. Let's see. So those siphons, the beams you can see there are 10 centimeters, so the siphons are coming out 3 or 4 centimeters from the wood. Okay, we can pick these up.
Roger.
All right. So.
Can you reach that far one? No, the four of them. Oh, okay. Let me just porch out of you.
Go ahead, you sharp or go up.
There's a question about Ozodax, and I've been lucky enough to work on Ozodax for the last 15 years or so. Was involved in the early description of Ozodax back in 2004. And most recently in 2018, we had been working on the evolution of Ozodax but hadn't really named a lot of the species. So we published a lot of the California species in 2018. And so now we're up to, I think, 18 species named here in California. We're sitting on a few other new ones now that we've discovered from the Gulf of Mexico, Costa Rica, Australia, New Zealand. And there'll be some more new Ozodax coming out in the next few years. Yes, that's right. Male Ozodax generally are very small. In all but one of the species so far, we know the males are dwarf males that live in what I call little harems.
Do you want to get this one here?
Yeah, thanks. Okay, thank you. There's my friend Z. Hi, Z. Look forward to seeing you on the Falkor in a few months. We'll be dissecting out these xylophaga, and maybe your species is in here. But we can't tell from just looking at the we can't tell from just looking at the siphons. Wood 9.
Yeah.
Wood 9? Or wood... Shouldn't be a 9, should be an 8.
Did you see the number? It should be 7 or 8.
I'll check in the papers.
Yeah.
Ask the chat.
Yeah. Well, by elimination, we'll see what number this one has. Right, we're gonna get another piece of wood.
You okay with putting in this one?
Yes, no problem. So here you can see all the siphons have withdrawn, leaving the tubes of the polychaete worms still there, and you can see some of the siphons still just poking out, but mostly they've retracted into the wood. Okay, thanks Cody. And that is wood 8.
It's going into red purple, which is number 10.
Number 10? Yeah.
up a rock from here?
Have we got all the rocks?
Yeah.
One.
I think Cody's asking if you want to pick up a different rock, like a non-experimental rock.
Yeah, non-experimental.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Did I miscount? Have we picked
up
8 things?
We've got 4 in this back box.
4 in the bag.
1 in the front.
2 in the front.
2 in the front.
Seven.
Here I see 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, maybe that's wrong.
I think that 1 is a marker.
Yeah, we got a marker over here. See, it was to the left of the wood. But you're right. I think... Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 things and a marker. No, you're right.
Cool.
Yep. And we'll pick the marker up later. We just have to remember.
Okay. Do you want to pick up a rock right here?
Sure.
Close this box?
Yes. If there's a good rock.
I think there's that one that's There's this one here. There's this one right there. Another one that the marker is like
I think you'd like a rock with a sponge on it.
Well, yes, but I don't see that here.
Not here, not unless we move.
But I would pick one or two.
Yeah, if there's anything in reach that's the right size. Yeah, that's a good one.
We caught on a loop. We just caught in loops. Loop-de-doop, Cody. Loop-de-doop.
Something working way too smoothly.
It's a fish.
Tied two or three of these boxes together.
It's a hatchet fish. Yeah, normally a mid-water fish, so it's interesting it's down near the bottom. There's a hatchet fish swimming around in front of us, probably. It's interesting.
I think that's what the teal was supposed to be for.
That's what me and...
Like some teal opens.
The teal opens. The purple one opens.
Purple is the bungees.
Exactly. And then someone put some loops on it. Alright, you want to get a good zoom in this round?
Yes, please, Cody.
Sorry. Bring it up in the view now.
Nice big tube there on that rock. Okay.
Does it go into
11?
Let's go in. Yeah.
11.
Yay. Don't have to bother with that box again.
There you go.
Good job. I think I like the look of this rocky surface here for a slurp.
That's good.
It'll be good.
I mean, migrate to the sleep for a minute. To be honest with you, I didn't really like the way I porched in and that thing stayed with me. It felt like they tied to the porch.
I think if you just the whole where the wood blocks were,
okay.
And I think it's pretty much the rocky surface, so you can slope it all.
Full suction.
Shouldn't be too deep under there. Yeah, that's good. Number one.
Right. Wait, see eight on the other side. There's eight jars or nine?
Eight.
Index in one. Other way. Right there. There it goes.
Do you remember which wood that was? Was that seven or eight on that spot?
That was seven, and this was eight. Yeah.
Greg would like you to suck up those sea stars for me as well.
You're welcome.
And they're not typically white, are they?
You could suck that slurpy sea star up. It's a nice little one to dry out, right?
Yeah.
We can dehydrate it for you.
Awesome. Go my box of memories with the trip.
Let's see if we can get a name on it for you.
The last time the Falkor, the first and last time they invited me out.
Hardly. I doubt that. Oh yeah, you got it?
Is
that
another cucumber or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You can see where the rock was in contact with the wood. We've got a bit of black sulfide underneath, so it went anoxic where the wood was in contact with the rock. But this sediment should be full of lots of little macrofauna, little polychaetes, and we'll be sieving those out tonight once the ROV's back on board.
Should be fine.
There's worse places to be put when you dive in the bottom of the ocean. And you get to benefit science. I'm in.
And we'll come back in a few years for you for the oceanics, right?
Yeah, we're just gonna leave it here.
Put one of Kira's rocks next to me with like some inscription on it.
Moralized forever on the bottom of the floor.
Would you like me to go get a little suction over where the bones were?
Maybe we'll index. We've got plenty of chambers. So.
Huh?
Yeah, let's do another one.
Rock.
Yeah, so we'll call this a wood associated slope. Really good to slope on a flat rock like this.
Oh.
Don't have to worry about poking it in too much.
Having a great time.
It's really good. Let's see. Last year it was still pretty covered in sediment then. Fantastic.
I'll go ahead and turn the section off and index to number 2. Section's off. Indexing. We are indexed. Hi, Mom.
So, I'm going to pan right.
Is it where the crab is?
The crab is?
I think so, yeah. Oh, it's a bit deeper there. Number 2. Just say near bone cage.
My mom has already laid claim to that sea star. I haven't even got it yet. She's
right.
Listening and she said, oh.
I hope it's in that chamber. Yeah. We'll pull it out for you.
How's that?
Maybe, that's fantastic. I like it when we find a flat rock. Well, I think we should look for another white star just to be sure.
I'm sure it's fine.
Okay, we are
indexing, so we'll call that one what?
bone slurp. Let's call it bone cage slurp.
Do you have a Q1 for the
quivers? No, Q. Normally we still call it jar one. Jar one and jar two. What went into six? Rock PR2. So we've got four more spots. We'll go around, see if we can find something with a sponge or a coral on it.
I already have my eyes on
it. Oh, you saw something?
One.
Okay.
There's a sponge right there.
That one?
That one?
The rock's pretty big though.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ready to go?
Yeah, thanks, and...
Okay, so from this case we took 1 through 4, right?
Yeah. Yes.
1 and 2... I was trying to update this.
Do you know those?
Well, just
know. Do you want more replicates of this? There are a lot of them here. This is Heteropolypus.
Ah, is it? I thought it's a crab.
No.
Yes, also.
Yeah, but in a different box.
You want that?
I think she really wants the sponge. But
let's get that.
Then we'll collect some of these guys too.
Okay. You wanna suction that one, or is that one you're gonna grab it from the box?
Oh.
Yeah, we could.
That could suction.
Totally suction that.
I can just swoop forward and touch with that pink thing on the top. So we get suck it.
Suck it. Yes, please.
I wanna zoom in on it, right? Or Jerry, zoom in on it.
I'll zoom in on it now. You like it? Okay.
It's pretty. We'll take it.
Okay. There's a lot of them around here. So
okay.
You can get several replicates if you want.
Yeah. That would be good. Let's get this one. And I'd like the big one as well.
Uh-huh.
And then if we find another one of the red ones.
Yeah, we saw three red ones just
okay.
Near here. So we'll have no trouble getting more.
Yeah.
I'm going to bounce forward if you're ready.
Yes, all set. Yes.
And suction is on lightly.
Over U or O
again? US, yeah. So we've just slurp sampled a octocoral, sometimes called a mushroom coral. Its genus is Heteropolypus, and we'll probably get a couple of them. Johanna, who is here with me, she's working with Paul Jensen, and they're looking at the biopharmaceutical potential of these corals and sponges that we've been collecting over the last few dives. And we're going to grab a large vase glass sponge in a minute and probably slurp some more of those mushroom corals.
Now, where would you like to go?
We'll go and grab the
the
vase sponge, please.
The big sponge off to the starboard.
Gotcha.
Okay. Yeah. I'll put it away.
Yay!
Those things are so cool.
Can we leave the base of it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Stalked what?
Stalked goiter sponge.
Goiter?
Next to the Pepsi can. Oh, 7-Up.
Yeah, a little cup coral. Is it 7-Up? Some interesting little. I think they're little snails, little gastropods. We should, hopefully, they'll come up. And living in the. We'll pinch it off. It's pretty big. You gotta fit it in that chamber, right?
So.
Do you want
to? If you cut it there, it should be enough. What do you think?
Right.
Oh, wow, it's very big. Okay.
Watch out.
Did you get a grab of that?
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. What is the can? Yeah, it looks like a Pepsi. No, not a Pepsi. 7-Up can. If you're not used to using the lasers, the 10 centimeter lasers, 4 inches apart, then you've got the can for reference to give you an idea of how big this sponge is. And we're going to put it inside a chamber of our bio box. It's not very big, so we want to give this sponge a chance to regrow. So we're going to take a piece of it, hopefully.
Mm-hmm. So it should be squishable. It's a different color from the other ones, like those in the background, those are also sponges, right?
Yeah, they're Ferrea. Oh no, they're not.
Sure.
It's a different sponge, yeah. So we've had a change. Cody stepped out and now J-Rod's. Yes,
yeah,
please, J-Rod. Running the manipulators. Whoops. Well, The base of the sponge is still there and it will be able to regrow. And we'll gladly take this whole sponge and they'll use it for... Well, do you want to explain what you're going to do with it, Johanna?
I'm going to look at the bacteria that are in its tissue. And maybe we also will try to grow some of the bacteria that are symbiotic to the sponge, because they're usually very different from the bacteria that are in the water or in the sediment or anywhere else, anywhere other. Also, they're very different from other other animals. And the sponges often, they produce interesting chemicals. That's why those chemicals are usually toxic to a lot of things. So that's why often they are very clean, because nothing else can grow on them, because they defend themselves chemically. And those chemicals, they're also interesting for us, because they can be used as antibiotics or anti-cancer molecules. So we will try to look which ones are there in this one and maybe create some new medicine. Feel free, just push it down.
It's okay if it breaks up.
And those deep sea sponges, they're hexactinella sponges, so they have this skeleton out of silica. And their texture is very interesting because it's very rugged and sturdy. And at the same time, it's extremely soft, as maybe you can guess from that what's happening right now. But yeah, they have skeleton out of glass, and that's pretty cool, I think.
Okay, well, the more you have, you
like.
I think so, yeah. Well done.
Anything else from right here?
Any rock reachable? Let's see.
One next to the
camera.
What do you think?
There's definitely something to reach. Any of those three or four? The bigger one?
I think it's too big.
They were just there, I saw.
Boxes.
Oh, they don't go that far.
No, it's just the lid is blocked.
Thank you.
see the one right next to 7 up there, and it moved, and it was about the same.
Yeah, it might be.
Pretty big, but it should be all right.
Big spaghetti worm tubes there on the side. Lots of tubes poking out on the top. Yeah, that's a good rock.
Thanks. Thanks, J-Rod.
So hi James, there was a question if we use protein sequencing. We don't, we do DNA sequencing. So I'm gonna mostly look at 16S genes from bacteria, and then we also gonna look at some functional genes that are interesting for bioactive compound production in bacteria. Wow. Nice.
Turns out you knocked three of the walls off if it's in the wrong way.
I'm not getting the walls off.
No, it was perfect.
Yeah.
Anything else around here? No, let's see if we can find another mushroom coral.
I think I'm good with mushroom coral, actually. I'd rather get another sponge again.
Another sponge, okay.
Yeah, always sponge.
It was better for sponges here than
this
morning.
One of the best sections we've seen.
Yes.
Even though the oxygen's very low, we're seeing it. Well, sponges can tolerate pretty low oxygen. That may be part of it.
Because sponges are extremely old animals, and they probably evolved before. Well, they could have evolved before there was a lot of oxygen around on Earth. That's one of the theories why they can live in such low oxygen conditions. So they really don't need much, which is pretty cool. And about the sequencing, still we also will do probably some metagenomics on those sponges as well, so we can get a big overview of all kinds of different genes that are in the microbiome, and in this case also in the sponge itself. Now we're gonna hunt some more.
Okay, Joanna, which kind of sponge are you looking for?
Can we zoom in on that furry one there? The straight ahead. I'm gonna an idea of if it's one or more and how big it is. So what do you think?
Looks like
it's like two different ones.
Yeah, I think it's several.
Maybe we can just like look around a little bit more and see.
You'd like a big one of that kind?
Yeah, preferably.
Yeah. Okay.
So not that one, but
yeah,
it's variety.
I'm not exactly sure what this is. Thanks, James.
What was that?
I was talking to James. I think, yes.
Can I go ahead and zoom in on it?
Yeah, those are all really small, right? I thought there were some quite large ones in the area.
Okay, we can go look for one.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's 10 centimeters.
Yeah, that's... It's a little small.
Okay.
Paul wants to have big things for metabolomics.
Okay, we'll look around for a big one.
Do you know what this stalk is, Greg?
That's the asbestopluma, the carnivorous spun.
Is it?
Yeah.
It looks very different from the one. Can we grab that one then?
The little one?
Well, I mean, just as a replicate for the one that we had already.
From before?
Yeah, we collected one of
those. We could slope
stalks.
That.
Yeah, that we could try that.
This little stalk
little
here.
Thing. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, asbesto pluma. Well, we tend to call those ones. There's probably a lot of different kinds.
They're very unknown, as far as I know.
Yes, please, J-Ron. Number four? We've gotten
two.
We have two more slots. You want four rocks?
That's what we got this morning.
Yep. There's a lot of life on this rock, lots of brittle stars, branching forams. We're trying to get this little carnivorous sponge here on a white stalk creature.
It has little tiny hooks made out of glass with which it catches little critters from the water column, like small shrimp, and then it grows its tissue around them and engulfs them, and I think it's the creepiest thing I ever heard.
Well, there's plants that do that, like the sundews, similar kind of mechanism, except sundews are sticky, these ones have spiky little hooks. If we see another one and we can get a close-up, we'll show you the spines coming out along the side of the sponge. Yeah, there he goes. He's beautifully done. And there it goes.
And he's in the jar.
Great job, guys.
So we need the other two boxes for rocks. And so unless we find a sponge on a rock, we'll have to slope it.
Thank you.
was this one called again? You
yes.
said?
Asbesto.
Asbesto.
So we've got a few more rocks to get and then we'll be wrapping up. It's a little bit early today. We've got a lot of stuff to do in the lab tonight. Tomorrow we'll be back to exploration and sampling. We'll be at something called the Crespi Knoll. Pretty close by. We're now pretty much going to be here for the rest of the cruise offshore from LA, Los Angeles. And we will be finishing up in San Diego on Friday the 6th of August. So we've got dives through the next 5 days. Well, I think we're meant to get rocks, so the ideal thing would be a sponge on a rock, something like that.
I think that one
right. Yeah, which if it's not too big, could be a good one. Unless you don't like that sponge.
Of course, I like that sponge.
It's like the rock,
big rock.
Okay.
Even has an anemone on it.
Yeah. How about this one?
This is a rock with a rock pen on it.
Yeah, that would be an option as well.
Yeah. Well, we'll keep looking. We've got plenty.
Wow.
We've got a bit of time. But unfortunately, the rock's too big. Oh, yeah. There's a yellow sponge on a rock that might not be...
I would need that one as well.
That's a sea cucumber. Oh, this is a dead sponge. Yeah.
Oh.
There's a skeleton of a sponge in the middle of the screen. When we're talking about carnivorous sponges, we're meaning ones that prey on animals. So they really will be catching copepods or other planktonic organisms, as opposed to other sponges, which are filter feeders and are largely eating protists or bacteria. So they're all heterotrophic, but they're preying on different size classes of organisms.
But there are a kind of heterotrophic, autotrophic sponges, but they live in shallow waters. They have cyanobacterial symbionts, and those symbionts can create a lot of the energy for the sponge by photosynthesis, similar to coral. So those would maybe qualify. What is the stalk behind that?
I think it's a little bubblegum coral.
Really?
So in that case, they'd be mixotrophic, right?
You want that rock?
If you're a combination of an autotroph and a heterotroph.
Yeah.
Do you think let's see how big it is. Yeah, it's a good rock.
That is just the right size.
As long as it doesn't go for it. Endlessly under.
I'm not 100% sure that sponge is actually attached to the rock.
Yeah,
I think
normally it should be attached to something. But
maybe we can land so that worst case we could also grab the one behind. Well, we don't manage, right? We would reach the other one as well.
Glenn, are you talking to me?
Sorry, yes. Actually, not really relevant, because you could also grab the other rock then, just in case the first one doesn't work out for some reason, right?
Yeah. I mean, we're not really locked in anything.
It's a big rock. Well, if we can get a rock with a sponge, that's what we'll do.
So we get kind of heavy.
So we've got limited space in our containers, and we don't want to cross-contaminate, like putting sponges in with rocks that we collected for the ecological aspect. So if we can get a rock that has a sponge on it or a coral, then we're going to choose that, and then two different teams can utilize it. Yeah,
yes,
I could.
Please.
Not sure what the sponge is. It has some little polychaetes living inside it. Those are the pink, lines in there. They're obscured because they're inside the sponge. They probably live in galleries inside the sponge their whole lives. And then behind it we have a little baby bubblegum coral, Paragorgia. And we're hoping both of these are attached to the rock. Okay, thanks, Jero.
There's also an anemone.
And an anemone, yeah.
Very camouflaged one.
Want to take it straight to the box? We won't worry with a photo. Well, we've got one.
Yeah.
I think. What do you think?
Still in the parameters. Maybe just barely.
It'll be close. Yeah.
to remember the marker.
Wow.
Wow.
I'm nailing it today.
Amazing. Great work.
Who just did that?
J-Rod.
That was epic.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Two hundred sample.
All right.
Okay, let's see if we can find another one as interesting as that. Amazing.
A little something for everybody.
Anemone, bubblegum coral. I'm just going to zoom on this thing. Remains of a stalk of a call it a tulip sponge would have stood about this tall, and the sponge is gone, and the stalk is spiral glass threads, and so they've all come apart. So they would have formed a coil, and that thing could have been standing up a meter. Maybe we'll see a live one. Haven't seen one yet. Okay, we got one more chamber to fill.
Got a couple of big rocks here. We're not coming up to see, but like we used to.
The rock team is going to be happy.
I just wanted to see if we'd actually.
Thank you, Nick. One more rock. Hopefully with...
That's why. You know,
block one too.
That's a huge one.
Oh, wow.
It's like a mushroom cloud. We'll leave that one alone.
Otherwise, this one here in the front room, it's awesome.
It's a big lithotid crab, that one. No thanks. We've got nowhere to put it.
I got some tonies. What's that rope?
Is it rope? Have a look at it. It's some kind of strapping. No, I don't know the name of this sponge, but it's spectacular.
It is.
What are those old record players called?
So big.
Gramophone. Yeah.
That's the name of it.
It should be.
Yeah, the trumpet of a gramophone.
Yeah. So, we are trying to get another rock as well, right? So
yes. Rock with something attached to it.
Okay, so another huge one. Two big ones. So I think this white one here on the left, that's the same shape but a different sponge. Right.
The rock will come.
Yeah, how about this? What is going there?
A little paragorgia.
Is it? Okay.
Yep. We can take that.
It's
a good size. Or you've had enough paragorgia?
I'm good with paragorgia, to be honest.
Okay.
So how about sorry,
we can keep going.
Yeah, let's keep going a bit.
No sponge on it?
Yeah, we'll go for a sponge.
Rock with a sponge, preferably.
Trash.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot more trash today. We've come in.
What was that rock
right there? Quite a way offshore at the San Juan Seamount and then the Little Joe Seamount. We saw very little in the way of trash or line, and today we've seen quite a lot. No, it's. It doesn't. Yeah, it's just a skeleton. Yeah. That's a sponge. Yeah. Unfortunately, the rock is too big. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Very cool. Wow. So they seem to like it down here.
Yeah, that's an interesting one.
That's super nice.
You want that one, or is that too small?
Can we zoom in on that big rock there?
To the left?
The yellow.
Oh, and there's a hagfish.
And a hagfish.
Tony loves hagfish.
Wow. That looks super cool. Thanks, guys. There's a small rock on top of a big rock here?
Yeah, unfortunately not.
No?
Yeah.
Not too bad. Yeah, let's take some good pictures for Devin. He would like that.
It's a... there's something about hagfish.
He just asked for the picture.
Okay.
Is this a fish?
Yeah, this is a hagfish, so it's a jawless fish.
A jawless fish without eyes?
Without eyes, yep. So it's related to lampreys that live in the freshwater. And it just waits for some carcass to fall on the seafloor and then goes and scavenges. Can wait for quite a long time. They're phenomenal producers of mucus. If you put one of those in a bucket, it'll turn the bucket completely solid with mucus. Just incredible. It's a protein mucus that, when it hits water from being secreted by the skin, expands incredibly.
So are those white spots where his eyes used to be?
I'm not sure what the spots are. It's obviously a little bit disturbed by the light, so they might still have some photosensors.
He wants to get away.
Look at that.
Wow.
Yeah. All right. We'll keep going. Thank you. Leave the hagfish to its whatever it's doing.
Alright, are we moving on?
Yes, please.
Is that
it's a sponge, yeah. We've looked at those, but not been able to get one.
It looked like a sea cucumber.
Well, we never tried. And now we don't have room. We need to get a rock. Yeah.
How about that rock on the right
there's
here?
There's a rock coming up. One rock.
This one?
One there.
It's too big.
This
is
okay.
A big that size
right.
Is okay.
Right.
That's a good size. Yeah. Yeah, we like look at the beams and we say a little bit bigger than the beams.
Okay.
I'll zoom in on one. I think it's plastic.
That's the second one I've seen.
We've seen about 10.
Oh,
quite
yeah.
A few.
Yeah. When we were hunting around for the experiments.
There you go.
Thank you. I'll have a look at it. I think it's a... I wonder if that's garage floor tiling. You know, those plastic sheets?
Yeah.
Well, the spaghetti worms like it. It's quite
cool.
A few and a beautiful brittle star underneath as well.
That is a weird looking worm.
Yeah, it's not the garage floor. Flooring I was thinking of. But. So the spaghetti worms live in these sandy tubes. They have spaghetti-like tentacles and then beautiful red branching gills. So we've got
There you can see the feathery gills, the spaghetti-like tentacles, and the wormy body going off to the left, to the right, sorry. And the tube of this one's a bit split open, but there's several others as well. And these worms can tolerate relatively low oxygen because they have such fantastically elaborate gills that you can see there, and quite a lot of blood. So they have hemoglobin that they use to breathe. Okay, thanks, Jaira.
That was artfully placed.
Okay, it's a little sponge, but is that okay? Okay, it's because we should
be
trying to wrap up.
Unless the other one here on the right.
It's too big. I think it's too big.
The smaller one. You think it's too
this
big?
One?
This one, yes.
I think that's too big.
Yeah. Okay, let's get the other one.
There is that one, but I...
Yeah, that sponge is smaller, I guess.
Yeah.
Or is it two different ones?
No, we'll try this one.
Let's try.
Okay. Yes,
yeah.
Please. It's pretty big. Yeah. Yeah,
yes.
No.
Okay. Well, we can also just get another rock powder sponge if that helps, so...
Maybe we should...
How about this other one there? Square. The square one. Or is it too big?
This one is too big.
Okay.
The left one is okay.
Yeah.
Depending how big it is underneath.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes they go down into the sediment.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a bit big.
You think so?
No. You know better than me.
Jared can make everything fit.
Yeah. to the millimeter. You were, yeah. Okay. After this, we've got to go get our marker, maybe get some more water, and then we'll be heading up. We've got a lot of work in the lab tonight. Tomorrow, though, we'll be at the Crespi Knoll, nearby. Another relatively shallow dive, no more than 1,000 meters. We haven't seen the full dive plan yet, but it'll be more of an exploration dive than today, where we just were picking up experiments. Okay, thank you. Take a quick pick. Okay. Yeah, two very interesting sponges on this rock.
Yeah.
And
very fluffy, the first
one. Well, that's still amazing.
Yes. Good job.
Well, we normally get rocks that are much smaller than this, J-Rod has picked up three rocks that literally just fit in the compartments.
Texas rocks
from Team Texas.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Trademark.
Yeah, the rock team, they've got a lot of work tonight. Picking all the creatures off those rocks. Yep, so we've got four rocks plus the seven experiments plus a big sponge. And several slopes.
Very prolific.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll take off about in the next 30 minutes or so?
Oh, yeah.
Minutes.
Yeah, let's head back, get the marker.
We'll do the rest of the Miskins. Where do you want to put those Miskins at?
Good question.
Because we've got 5 and 6 left.
I would take another one.
Okay, you want to do them both? Where?
Let's do them both.
When we're off?
When we're off.
Okay.
Or like after closing the box, once the sediment settled again a bit.
Take 2 miskins and come up, so probably next 20 to 30 minutes. Come out, next to it, they'll be all lit up.
Happy day, Brad.
Fortunately, sir. Red. Marker?
Yes, please.
Marker.
Sorry, you want the Niskins while we're flying? Just when we get back to the marker?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay.
It's still a little muddy, but that's okay, because I need to have a ground control for the microbiome things. So that's the water and whatever else is in the background, like all this sediment that's fallen. So
you want to be a meter off the bottom, sort of thing?
Yeah.
So we're just going back to get our marker for our site. We didn't want to have it on the porch because it floats and would have obscured the camera. So we'll pick that up, take 2 last water samples, and then we'll be wrapping up for the day. There it is. Grabbed on the fly.
Nice.
Okay, where would you like to take those new skins?
All right, everybody. Thanks for joining us today on our second dive.
Where is RV?
We are going to ascend now, and we'll be back in the water tomorrow at 8 a.m. Pacific time, diving on the Crespi Knoll. So hope you can join us then.
Thanks everybody for watching. This is Schmidt Ocean Institute Research Vessel Falkor and ROV Sebastian. We are just recovering the vehicle now, just under 100 meters to go to the surface. This is your first time watching a recovery. You have four windows on the screen. The left two are a tooling cameras, the bullet and a camera that's pointed after the vehicle. It's listed as skid, but it's actually behind the vehicle so they can watch the umbilical. The top one is the bullet cam, so that's the, they call it the bullet, where the cable is terminated to the vehicle. And then the upper right is the science, 4K science camera, and the lower right is the aft deck. Floats on surface. Floats around the surface.
You're not directly after the vessel. Speaking of water, you want to turn the docking head water on?
So the yellow floats you see on the surface in the lower right-hand corner are on the umbilical cable to keep it up off the vehicle when it's in the water column. It's 12 floats total, a series of 10 and then 2. Tarot is flying the vehicle and Cody's running the aft deck. Nick's operating the winch, so they're backing the vehicle up towards the ship and paying in the winch. When the floats get closer, they'll bring the cable into the ship closer and the deck hands will take the floats off. So tomorrow's dive is on a location called Crespi Knoll. We dove on this during FK 18-1005, the backyard deep expedition. So if you want to go back to your records, that was dive 169 of Sebastian. Tomorrow will be 448. And then the day after that will be Lisan, and that was dive 170 from that expedition. So a couple hundred dives under our belt now.
Ben said what?
Ben was replacing the handles on it.
No, they were, it seems like they were put on the opposite way. Afloat.
Opposite way, they're like...
like, the latch is on port side of the vessel, not starboard side of the vessel.
That means the cable, although they weren't. Liz put them on this morning. They were facing me, and I was on the starboard side of the vessel.
They were just put on normally this morning.
That's really weird.
Are they showing up on the other side? But it does seem to be the tend of the of the umbilical, right?
Yeah.
You guys are having a conversation about what direction the floats are coming up.
How are they looking right now? Do I need to pull away or?
No,
you're good. Okay. There's a pyrosome right there in the camera. So that's A-frame back out for the last set of floats. There'll be two more to remove, then the vehicle will come on deck. So A-framing in for the last two floats.
Dara, keep coming back. Good position. How's your belly looking?
It's alright.
Too much? I can't see it yet.
Yeah, it's all big, green. But it's not horrible.
Yeah, I can't see it just yet, so. Just go by your own discretion.
I
see your belly.
There we go, it's good now. Come on.
Alright, I got a visual of it now? Stick back there up. We can get you. Alright, come on up, mate.
Coming up.
And hold you out there.
Easy
up.
Easy up.
And Darrow, just hold that position and we'll grab you.
Coming up.
Coming up all the time, all the time. And we got you. Almost.
That's ROV Sebastian out of the water. Splashing out of the water. Thanks everybody for joining us. This is Schmidt Ocean Institute, research vessel Falkor and ROV Sebastian. We'll see you guys tomorrow. We're off deck at 8 a.m., so a little bit later in the morning.
Right.
We've had 3 days of early morning 6 a.m. dive, so a little bit later for the guys. And we'll be in from about 8 to 5. So we'll be on Crespi Knoll, just off the 100 nautical miles off the coast of San Diego. So this location tomorrow is
I'll measure it.
It's a little bit closer to the beach.
And down.
25 nautical miles off the coast. And that's ROV on deck. I asked them, J-Rod's giving me a bit of lip over a nice coffee I'm drinking, but I offered for iced coffees when I walked out of the room. Yeah, I did. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow.